Who's running things in your home, you or your kids? Find out how to discipline your kids effectively. Next on Keeping Kids Healthy. I'm Dr. Winnie King, here in the lobby of the Children's Hospital at Montefiore in New York City. Now, every parent has had their moments of doubt and confusion about discipline. Am I too strict or too soft? Why don't timeouts work? And is rewarding my kids for good behavior just a form of bribery? And is that okay? Well, there are a lot of opinions out there, but there are some tried and true solutions as well. So we've gathered together some experts and some real-life moms to help you figure out what works. Get your pencils ready. You may want to take notes. But no one person can have all the answers. Meet Nancy Mitchell, mother of two. Jim Bunn has her story.
Whoa, nice jump.
Nancy Mitchell is like a lot of mothers.
Okay, gonna try in unison?
With her 8-year-old daughter Lauren and 3.5-year-old son Andrew and Chase, their neighbor, Nancy has her hands full trying to maintain order.
Children, they know. They know sometimes how to push your buttons. Stop.
I'm not gonna do it.
And I find that I can withstand a lot of pressure, but I just keep going and going and going, and I can't recognize when I'm gonna go over the edge.
Chase, I'm swimming.
No, let Chase try the same thing. Lauren. Lauren, calm down. Look at me. Lauren. Do you want to go to your room?
I feel bad afterwards because probably I'm a bit more extreme than I would be if, you know, if I had taken a step back and thought about it. But, you know, when you're in the moment, you just react.
One of Nancy's greatest challenges is having to deal with each child differently.
My children don't like when I shout. I can't help it, but that's probably one of my weak parts. And I'd like, to be honest, I'd like to change that. And what's interesting is the little one, really, before I even get to my breaking point, I'm not even close to being there. I'm just raising my voice slightly more than a normal speaking tone with him. He doesn't like it. So he will right away listen to me and do what I... But the other one, she's a little bit more feisty, I like to say. She doesn't seem to, it doesn't matter with her.
You know that's not loud. Sit down. If you want to get up, you ask me if you're permitted.
In some instances, she will use physical punishment.
There is definitely a time and place for it. When they're, an example being if they're running into the middle of the street. I think, you know, that time for words isn't going to really work, whereas a little tap on the behind will give shock value as well as an unexpected response, and it will actually shake them, and they'll realize.
Nancy has learned that trying to correct every bad behavior every time simply doesn't work.
Picking your battles. When things are very serious or harmful, obviously those issues need to be dealt with. But I think a lot of parents would be constantly badgering their children and staying on top of them and almost limiting their growth and development if every single thing they did was acted upon. I think you have to decide what's important to you and what isn't. And important to obviously the child's well-being. Okay, I was wrong. Did that hurt?
No.
No?
Pick your battles. That sounds like good advice. Well, to start getting you some answers, we brought Nancy and a group of other moms together to tell us their toughest problems with discipline and to share what works for them in the process. Childhood expert and mother, Dr. Lori Green, was there too, along with all their kids.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
So the first thing that we're curious about is, do you guys have your own sort of discipline strategy or philosophy that you tend to use in general?
There's no one-size-fit-all routine for any kid.
So, I mean, three kids, one is night, one is day. Like, how do you plan that ahead of time? So you just need to know, like, okay, are you a firm parent? Are you going to follow through? And you just, basically, that's all you need to plan out.
I find out if I don't follow through, I've kind of gone against, you know, what my words were, how I want to discipline.
While a lot of people kind of imagine discipline equals punishment, really what discipline is a series of parenting ideas that you use to get your child to become behaviorally the person that you want your child to become.
There are times that I won't follow through, but on the times that I have, I'm proud of myself as much as I'm proud of them, because they'll know that I'm serious.
You know, my little boy, he's three. He's horrified when he gets sent to his room. My daughter doesn't really care, so I find for her, she's a little bit older, she's eight. I usually take something away she loves.
You have to have like a little list in your
head. I'm always running in my head.
Of what you're gonna take away, because you can't, you know, you have to be able to follow through. Can't be you're not going to the birthday party when you know they're gonna end up going to the birthday party.
Right. With my kids, when they used to throw tantrums, I would talk to them before I take them into the grocery store. And I would let them know that you're expected to behave yourself. Yeah. You're not getting anything today. And you know, I expect nothing but good behavior. And I find that works the majority of the time, not all of the time, but the majority of the time it do work.
Of course, it's a good idea to think in advance about how you plan to discipline your child. But the truth is, so much of what happens in parenting is reacting in the moment. For example, I have children, and I'm the kind of parent who plans to always have an empathic response. So if my child hits another child because they took a toy, my plan is often to say, well, you know, of course you're upset that Tommy took your toy, and that's probably why you reached out to hit him, but hitting isn't okay, and this is why. And that's really a good sort of balanced reaction. But the truth is, sometimes if I see my son hit another child, I grab my son's hands, I say, no, that's not nice. I don't have the empathic response. And that might be just as effective. I think being a natural reactor is also a good thing to be.
Discipline styles have changed over the years, from a more authoritarian approach to one that's more communication-based.
I think much of the change has been what the consequences are. I mean, a lot of the same limits are there. We're not allowed to run across the street through traffic. We're not supposed to talk back to our parents. But it's when you cross the line, I think, where some of the changes have been. You know, a lot of parents are using the timeout nowadays instead of the spankings.
So we've talked a lot about consequences and sort of ways that we handle things when things aren't going wrong. What about when things are going right? How do you guys use positive reinforcement? Does anyone use star charts or any of those kinds of things?
It didn't work for me.
It really worked. It worked for me when we were consistent about it. I found that it's been really helpful with, you know, okay, you're going to get stars if you can get yourself ready in the morning and actually make it to the bus on time. That's a major star. It's like the positive reinforcement, it gives them esteem. Like they're just happier to do the right thing, it seems like.
It sort of sounds like when you're very specific about what you're targeting, like what it is that you can earn a star for, it works better than just like if you're good today.
For me, I'm from the Caribbean, and I think it's also a cultural thing, which is okay, but growing up, we always thought, okay, getting ready, brushing your teeth, it's what you do. So for my kids, for them, it's like, okay, you get up, you get ready for school. But I still tell them that I appreciate them doing it. But for them, they're like walking proud. Mom, did I brush my teeth? Is it white? Yes, honey, it's white. Good.
So you use your personality as a reason. Look, the real reason we want our kids to behave well is because, again, we want them to be whole, complete, wonderful, happy people that make other people happy and have good relationships, etc. We don't really want them to strictly do things for toys. Now, I think in a situation where, you know, kid and mom are really securely attached, or kid and parents are really securely attached and have a great relationship, and the kid really loves the good stuff, the kudos and the, you know, high fives, and that comes to be meaningful, a lot of times those kids just want to continue to make their mom happy, and that's why they'll clean their room. And if you have to start that with a star chart, that's fine.
Ryan, that's one. Give me the Game Boy. Thank you.
You're no fun.
So something that comes up a lot, you know, after an episode of discipline where, let's say, you scolded your child or asked, you know, had to put some consequence out there, sometimes mothers feel guilty. Parents feel guilty. So does anyone ever have that?
If it's a situation where I felt like I didn't handle it the best way I could have, I was too impatient, I'll wait, I'll calm down. And then I'll go and apologize for how I acted, because what I found is when you handle it in a quieter, calmer way, you get more of a response.
I'll feel that the times that I've yelled, they're now treating each other that way if they're angry at one another. And it does, it makes you stop and think.
Yeah.
I mean, we all just lose it.
I like what you said before about apologizing, because just like you said, that they'll model the yelling, they'll model the apologizing too. They'll model the stepping back.
I'm like, okay, you know what? And I mean, when I lose it, no one feels.
Nobody wants to be there.
My husband actually said, when I lose it, like, he puts himself on timeout. And I'm like,
I think those moments of like emotional saturation that we have as mothers, and we all have them. One thing that, you know, sometimes helps is paced breathing, where you breathe in and out of breaths of the same length. And you'll probably notice if you do this while you're losing it that your chest is going up and down. But if you can kind of bring your breathing down to your belly, breathe in and out, like, you know, push the breath out and make the in breath and the out breath sort of match. Well, maybe it sounds a little new agey.
If my kids are at it, you know, losing it, and I'm losing it, let's just do our yoga breaths.
Okay.
That's what and they'll look at me and they'll just, you
know? She was swinging a bat by accident and she hit me, and then I pushed her, and then we both got in trouble. I couldn't watch TV and I had to go to bed early, like. Really.
And what's that like?
It's not really fair.
Is this what normally happens?
Yeah, and then I get mad. Okay.
What I often say to parents who are frustrated with this is, you know, you're so lucky because siblings are practice for life. And, you know, siblings are, having kids who are struggling with their siblings, this is their opportunity to figure out how to get along with other people in life.
I noticed that, your little sister came over and started messing with you a little, is that true? And Connie, I noticed that you came over and you gave, just like this, messing just like this, you gave Lizzie sort of a chance on her own. You said, come on, you know, come on over, or you called her over, you gave her a chance on her own to repair her action.
Kind of like
and,
this.
And just sort of like this.
Elizabeth, stand up, please.
She's very strong. And then when she didn't do it, you went over and very calmly, matter-of-factly sort of intervened and said, not okay. You know, you kind of gave her a little pat and she, you know, she came back. And here she is, she's doing it again. And her job is to continue over and over to do this and drive poor Amanda a little nuts. Yeah. But your job is to over and over pull her
right.
away.
And Elizabeth, you are. See, because now you're really starting to annoy me.
Yeah.
I know, try to just walk away.
Yeah.
That's
well,
not the right thing to do, though, is it?
Okay, now
Elizabeth,
there's...
do you want to go home with Lori or you want to come in my car?
Yeah, she's bothering me.
No, okay, so I think... there. So she's letting her know what the potential consequence is. She won't get the ride home.
Did you want to go with Lori or come with
mom? Yes.
Okay, so we have to stop behaving like
okay.
that.
Okay.
Okay, see, that worked. Okay. Oh, well, there you go. You see, perfect. You let her know what the potential consequence was going to be. You oriented her. You gave her a chance. Right. She pulled it together. High five.
High five with the clean hand.
Way to go.
Good job, Liz.
Good job.
Good job, Amanda.
So it really does work. But now, what about when you're out in public, like the supermarket or a local restaurant, and your child starts acting up? What do you do then when people are watching? Well, one mom and dad secretly let us videotape their four girls during a lunch out. Let's see what happened.
My three oldest ones, they're pretty good, but the youngest one, she's usually the one who want to run around or bang on the table. So she started opening up all the sugar packets and she took the fork, she was eating all the ice and she dipped her finger, she was washing her face with the water.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
Usually I always go out with a book for them to draw, or I'll just give the youngest one my cell phone. Why don't you call grandpa or somebody? That usually works for like 5 minutes, and then you have to, I'm always thinking of the next thing to do.
As Maggie says, it is a good idea to bring something for the kids to do. But what can you do if things start to get out of control?
If a kid starts having a tantrum in a restaurant, for example, and this is a two-year-old, it's probably not going to work so well to say, sweetie, you're disrupting the other people, and we need to be, you know, calm in a restaurant, blah, blah, because a two-year-old's probably not going to respond to that kind of logic. So you might just... when the tantrum's really going, you might just pick the two-year-olds up and bring them out, give them a chance to, you know, cool down. And if they can, great, bring them back to the table. And if they can't, you might have to just. I mean, I'm sure plenty of parents have abandoned plenty of meals for that. I sure have.
If it gets out of control, I give them an ultimatum. I tell them, if you guys don't behave, we're just going to have to go. Or maybe you wouldn't have a dessert. You wouldn't have the icy or the ice cream. You know, they're not like that. And once you say that, they know they want their dessert. Everything just stops. If not, we just leave and we go, we take the food home or whatever.
If it's an older child who's a more kind of rational being, you might say, listen, I'm going to give you a chance to pull together right here at the table so we can stay and enjoy this meal, but if you can't do it, we're going to have to go. And you might just say it very matter-of-factly like that and see what happens, and then follow through. Otherwise, you've taught the child, if you don't follow through, it doesn't really matter what I do, we're going to get to stay anyway.
We finally told the girls that we were taping them, so we got their side of the story.
Sometimes I get really frustrated because my sister started acting up. They usually tell us to stop it. If they promise us we're going to a museum, and sometimes when we start acting up, they say, you're not going to go to the museum. My dad, he tells us to stop it, and we stop immediately.
Usually if I have them by myself without their father, and things really get hectic, I'm only human. I'm like, okay, that's it. We're going home now. And then I feel terrible. I feel like a bad mother, and because they're all mad at me.
Well, the DePass family didn't have to resort to this, but sometimes you really just have to get up and leave. Next, the eternal debate. Is spanking helpful or harmful? You hear a lot of passionate opinions on both sides, but is there any consensus?
As a parent, I think spanking is very effective, but it's got to be used in the right situation, and it does, I think, create a situation where, you know, after the child is spanked, they know not to do or do that behavior again.
The best way you can raise children is with just love and communication and understanding, and you do not need to spank a child.
They're running across the street, or if I see them going towards the hot stove, or they might be throwing rocks or something like that, that would be something I'd reinforce with a little slot.
I personally have found the spanking not to be the way to discipline my kids. I think for parents that do choose to spank, you need to keep some guidelines in mind. Never do it in anger. Taking a deep breath, counting to 10, discussing why the child deserves the consequence. And then, of course, the spanking needs to be gentle. If you leave marks on the child, you're going too far. If you hit the child in anger, you're going too far.
I don't think spanking is really good for kids because it only makes them more angry. The times that I got spanked, I really thought I was going to die.
I do not endorse spanking as a punishment for a couple of reasons. First of all, a spanking takes place in an arbitrary space and time. You know, your child, your two-year-old, you're holding your two-year-old's hand for some reason, you let go, they start to run out in traffic, and you grab them back. That's an appropriate use of a physical intervention. It's just a safety intervention. That's very different than you came home with a bad grade or I don't like what you did and now I'm going to give you a spanking. That's arbitrary. It probably won't be effective. It will probably teach your child to be fearful of you as opposed to see you as somebody to work problems out with. And it models this idea that the way to handle being disappointed in someone or not liking what they've done is to hit them.
You could either like take away his toys or punish him or like occasionally like just yell at him a little, but don't. There are other ways of disciplining your child.
Well, with all this input, has anyone done any studies about which discipline techniques work? Well, yes, they have. So let's take a look at one technique that doctors have actually studied on children with the most severe behavioral problems. And it worked. And if it worked for them, maybe it can work for you and your child. Let's meet Kate and her daughter, Ava.
My husband and I have been married for 23 years, and we have a 21-year-old son and a 19-year-old daughter. Several years ago, we decided that we wanted to adopt, and Ava was brought to our home. She was 9 months old, very, very active. And as time went on, she was more and more active. She had no fear, so that was the nerve-wracking part of it. She just would go about her way, stumbling down the stairs and not even think about the consequences. We were housebound for quite a while. We couldn't take her to any like wide open spaces, even like a park. She'd be climbing the highest, part of the playground and with no, you know, concerns for her safety or anyone else around her. I tried the standard timeouts, but that really didn't work with her. She just wouldn't cooperate with the timeout. And that's where I was kind of at a loss. As soon as she was legally adopted, we had her baptized. And I knew that it was going to be a difficult situation. She just, from the second she walked into the church, she just took off in this direction and that direction and yelling and not listening at all. And by the time we left there, she had no shoes on, her stockings were ripped, she had her dress hanging off on one side. She was just not controllable. Luckily, the priest was very understanding, but it still was humiliating. It really was. It was a sad day.
Ava was diagnosed with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder and something called oppositional defiant disorder, or ODD.
That means on a consistent, persistent basis, they don't comply with adult requests, they blame others, they have a negative attitude towards getting along with others. The families that avoid going into toy stores for fear that the kids will scream until they get what they want. These are kids who do not listen when told to do the simplest things like put on your seatbelt, hold my hand, we're crossing a busy street. They make it really hard to feel competent as a parent.
It was scary. I didn't really know what, you know, the future would hold.
Doctors began treating Ava with medication and something called parent-child interactive therapy.
When parents come to see us, they are coming in with this relationship with their child fractured in some way. And so the first part of the treatment is focused only on building that attachment back up.
This therapy consists of two parts. First, child-directed, then parent-directed play. The child-directed phase is intended to rebuild the parent-child relationship, and it focuses on positive reinforcement.
The first thing that struck me was how really basic and simple the whole idea was.
And so for very focused periods throughout the day, we teach parents to avoid giving all commands, to avoid asking all questions, and certainly to avoid being critical. So we've just boosted up the positives with the attention and the praises and the descriptions, and we've cut down the opportunities for negative interactions. And that has a very powerful effect.
You're doing such a great job playing with the toys, Ava.
We teach parents how to simply describe, like a play-by-play announcer, what the child is doing, and the child gets a sense, what I'm doing is valid, it's worthwhile, it's important, you're noticing me.
Now you're gonna have the lady with the pink dress lay down on the bed.
Praise, using specific praise. Reflect back what the child says, ignore the ignorable, describe what the child is doing, and be enthusiastic like a camp counselor.
Dr. Kurtz says the child-directed phase creates a bank account of positive experiences necessary to begin the more difficult parent-directed interaction.
And then we teach them how to give a simple, effective command. We explain that the word command isn't meant to be an order, but just a clear direction that you need to do this.
Put the blue block on top of the white block.
We teach them how to follow through if the child complies, which is a labeled praise. Thank you for following directions. I love when you follow my directions.
Very, very nice. Good job listening to the rules and following directions. I'm so proud of you.
If they don't, we immediately give a choice in the form of a warning. Either put the box in the box, or you'll need to sit in the timeout chair. It's said once, it is a choice at that point. I would estimate 100% of the parents that come to see us tell us that timeout doesn't work with their child. So we go over how to do a proper timeout. There are a short, specific amount of time that parents don't look at the child or talk to the child during the timeout. That when the child finishes the amount of time in the chair, they still need to comply with whatever got them into timeout in the first place. And some kids will test us out a bit in the beginning. They'll go to the timeout chair, and after 3 minutes, we'll go over and say, are you ready to put the blocks in the box? No. Okay, stay here until I tell you, you can get up. It's not uncommon for kids to do that 6, 7, 8 times that first session. But then they realize very quickly, we're gonna be really calm, we're gonna be really consistent, and it's really in my best interest to kind of get this over with. And then when they come back, they get back into time in. Time in has to be fun in order for time out not to be preferred.
Hello, Dr. Wexler.
It's good to see you.
Ava, come say hello to Dr. Wexler.
What's really important for us to teach parents is to stay calm in the process so that they're changing the child's behavior by the consequences of the behavior, not by how angry they get.
Come on over here.
The therapy worked for Ava.
And now face me.
You are doing such a good job.
We never back then would have dreamt of taking her to a restaurant. And now we can go as a family to a restaurant, and we are going on vacation on an airplane, on a cruise ship, and I don't really have too many concerns about, you know, her behaving any way other than a typical five-year-old.
It's not easy for kids to do all the things we tell them to do. We tell them when to get up. We tell them where to put the book bag. We tell them a lot of things. So giving them support for that, acknowledging that it's not always easy, tends to be a very health-promoting kind of behavior.
The biggest skill that we've gotten out of it that we use on a daily basis is like giving her choices, and she makes, and we say, you know, good girl, you did a great job, you made the right choice, and she loves that.
You make me happy with your face. You never know, care how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
What a success story. For more information, check out aboutourkids.org and our website, keepingkidshealthy.org. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time on Keeping Kids Healthy.